Chou Enlai, Prime Minister of Communist China, has been on the move since mid-December, subtly but deliberately spreading China's influence, first among the new rulers of Africa. Now in Pakistan. His first visit to the Indian subcontinent since his troops fought their brief sharp war with India 16 months ago. To the east of Karachi, two tiny states watch intently the Chinese leader's progress. They are Sikkim and Bhutan, wedged into the Himalayas between India and China. The Chinese offensive of 1962 just missed their borders. They know that if China were to move south again, they would be right in her path. Sikkim, the smallest of these states, has been a classic invasion route from the north. Today, India controls its foreign policy and security, and Chinese-held territory is not far away, by Himalayan standards. Another link with the West. In Gangtok a year ago, the Crown Prince of Sikkim married an American college student, Miss Hope Cook. Last December, the prince succeeded the Maharaja, his father. And only yesterday came news that the new Maharani has given birth
from the palace of Gangtok, King Tondup Namgyal rules in name. India controls defense and foreign affairs, and this is resented by many Sikkimese. And many still frown on the king's wedding 2 years ago to an American debutante, Miss Hope Cook.
For centuries, Sikkim's deep valley has ensured its freedom from outside interference. Here, the Sikkimese develop their own distinctive culture, which is little changed even today. Yet life in Sikkim is not always delightfully simple. Indeed, in some ways, it can be more complicated than Western civilization. Schools, for instance, have to teach their classes in six different languages because Sikkim's population is so mixed. Weaving classes do not need a language. The Sikkimese are proud of their local cloth. Tibetan exiles have brought their own skills to this traditional craft. Racial divisions create uncertainty in Sikkim despite the outward show of unity. The Nepalese are polygamous. As a result, they're already three-quarters of the population. The government of their homeland next door has shaken hands with Peking. The Sikkimese are teaching their children about the outside world through necessity rather than choice. And because the children learn about it at a time of violent change, their view of it is often one of anger and doubt. Pack mules, or more often human backs, are the commonest way of humping goods in these mountains. Roads are few, and human beings are cheaper than diesel engines. Even women help to carry military supplies on their backs to the Indian Army posts on Sikkim's northern and eastern frontiers. There's a confusing medley of races in Sikkim. In the market in Gangtok, the capital, you find at least six different nationalities rubbing shoulders. 7,000 are from Tibet. They fled there when China seized the country. Since the British left, an increasing number of people have come northward from hungry, crowded India. The young people of Gangtok have more idea of what life in the outside world is like than most others in the Himalayas. As they walk through the crowded streets, they can see a variety of imported goods for sale. They can also get a glimpse of the Indian cinema's romantic view of life. But Sikkim's Buddhist faith has resisted the pressure of India's Hindu religion. An institute of Tibetology was built after the Chinese conquered Tibet. It houses the documents and treasures the monks brought with them when they fled over the border. The foundation stone was laid by the Dalai Lama. The institute was then officially opened by Mr. Nehru. Inside, exiled monks ponder the Buddhist text which the Chinese have tried to discredit. Sacred objects from Tibet are preserved here, though the Sikkimese form of Buddhism, the red-robed sect, differs from the reformed yellow-robed faith of the Dalai Lama's people. While the monks brood on the infinite or study their texts, some 7,000 of their people live very different lives in refugee camps near Gangtok. The world was briefly concerned about the plight of the Tibetan people when the Chinese invaded. Then the world turned to other disasters. The people who had lived through the collapse of their old way of life were left to stagnate in camps like this one. Livestock has been paid for by the Sikkim government. They're rationed out with meticulous fairness by Sikkim's energetic Princess Kukula. The Indians used to intrigue against the Sikkimese rulers. Then the Chinese groomed a puppet prince of their own as claimant, and the Indians now support the royal family. The refugees suffer terribly from diseases like pneumonia and TB, almost unknown in their high mountains. Even here, there's no sense of self-pity. The Tibetans were the first of the mountain races to lose their old security. The Sikkimese are eager to develop their economy. They've made a start on the land. This imported Australian bull has introduced a superior strain by fathering calves from the smaller local cows. Livestock has been imported by the royal family to set an example to local farmers. Farmers are hard to convince about new methods. But the development plan is sensible. Sikkim hasn't clamored for steel mills or other status symbols of underdeveloped states. Sikkim makes good money from its orchids. They grow in a great sanctuary near the royal palace. Sales of orchids are controlled so that a steady supply reaches the West. Wherever you go in Sikkim, you see prayer flags fluttering over houses, temples, and hedgerows. In these high valleys, the gods seem very near. Prayer flags are a sign of faith, and everywhere there are shrines built by people who hope, by doing so, to gain grace in heaven. Temples are cluttered with ornaments as varied as you'd find in an antique shop. Many are mixed up with beliefs from a more primitive age. It's a long time since the Lord Buddha stepped over these hills from Nepal. His imprint has been somewhat blurred.
In the Scottish mission school at Gangtok, 30 miles from the Chinese outposts in Tibet, Sikkimese children were singing this week of a great victory over the big red dragon.
Sikkim
But the big red dragon in their classroom story is from the world of Himalayan folklore only. The world of reality lies northeast of Gangtok, along a road that winds its way 14,000 feet up through the snowy slopes of the Nathula Pass. It's one of the 13 main routes from Sikkim through the Himalayas to Chinese-occupied Tibet and to China itself. Here, last week, Chinese troops stood poised to attack as Peking delivered its ultimatum to New Delhi. China accused India of putting military installations on Chinese soil and gave the Indians 3 days to dismantle them. India at first denied the charge, then said that the installations were derelict anyway. As the ultimatum expired, the Chinese blandly announced that the offending outposts had been removed. While his troops kept up their border patrols, the Prime Minister, Mr. Shastri, again denied that they'd ever built any posts on the Chinese side of the border. The Chinese stuck to their guns and declared the matter is far from closed. For India's part, it wasn't closed. Her troops are here in far greater strength than when the Chinese invaded in 1962 and swamped the Indian defenses. Last week, they had 3 brief skirmishes with the Chinese and were heartened by the results. The Chinese reported a charge that the Indians had stolen 59 of their yaks and again accused India of occupying large areas of Chinese territory. The Kingdom of Sikkim, in fact, is an Indian protectorate. Its mountainous frontier may be a matter of dispute, but in the Nathula Pass, at least, it's clearly defined. Beyond the border stone lies Tibet, and Chinese troops in unknown quantity. Some reports put their number at up to 50,000. Other estimates say that they're in regimental strength only, about 3,000 men. Last week, the ITN Reports team came face to face with just a few of them. The team had been warned to expect machine gun fire, but found that the Chinese were interested in nothing more warlike than an exchange of camera shots. Of the Chinese armament, which is said to include howitzers and heavy mortars, no sign whatsoever. But though all's quiet on the border now, Indian troops remain on the alert in the knowledge that the pass through Sikkim has now become another potential starting point for a third world war. Ceasefire or not, the threat of Chinese invasion, years older than the threat of communism, still hangs over Sikkim and its capital, Gangtok. It has a romantic quality. Its palace guards wear ceremonial uniform. But it's not quite the Shangri-La it may seem at first sight. Today, the king has changed his feudal robes for the austere combat uniform of the 20th century to tour his threatened border. The king was accompanied to the front by the Indian political officer whose presence underlined the fact that Sikkim's future lies partly in Indian hands. And today, feudal Sikkim takes a more business-like approach to the dangers it faces, as Alan Hart found when he spoke to the king.
Sir, can you tell me, how serious did you consider the Chinese threat to be this time?
Well, we really didn't take the thing very seriously until the Chinese sent in a sort of, you might say, ultimatum, because they have been talking about this frontier a fortification which really doesn't exist. But when they did send in the ultimatum, we were rather worried.
How big was the build-up of Chinese troops just across your border?
Well, I think they had built up roughly to the size of a brigade, and they were actually spread out in attack formation.
How far did they cross into your own territory?
They came about 200 yards on one occasion, and of course they went back again.
Why was this? To provoke the Indian forces into firing, do you think?
I think it was to provoke the Indian army. I must say that the Indian army have been very patient with them, though they fired across the border 5 or 6 times. the fire was returned just twice.
What do you think was the main reason, the main objective of this Chinese threat and then the ultimatum?
Well, one's not really quite sure what they were trying to do. We do not believe that they really meant actually big business, because apart from the troops that they had in this part of the world, they're very dependent on the USSR for oil. So I don't think they meant an all-out war. So one assumes that it is to tie down Indian troops in actually this part of the world from going across to maybe Pakistan's side.
Looking to the future, sir, do you think the day will come when the Chinese will come and mean big business, as you put it?
Well, we hope that time won't come, but one can't be sure, because as we all know, China has said that their aim is, sort of might say, international communism. So it could mean, in some future date, trouble, but then we all have to hope for the best and be prepared for the worst.
Those preparations include a bigger emphasis on internal security. The Sikkim State Council has drawn up a crash program for more armed police. Their present strength is 280. It's hoped to double this within a month to provide more effective measures against Chinese infiltrators and resident malcontents who think the Chinese occupation might be good for trade. But Miss Martha Hamilton from Edinburgh, the only European in Sikkim today, has perhaps the toughest security job of all. Miss Hamilton, who's 35, is headmistress of the country's biggest girls' school. With only her small local staff, she had to prepare her 700 pupils for war.
In silence.
Miss Hamilton, having the responsibility for the safety of 700 children must have presented you with many problems.
Yes, well, there definitely were problems. Most of our children are very small. The majority of the 700 are under 12. And so we tried on the whole to keep it as a kind of game, really, especially with the very youngest ones. For instance, when they were cutting up paper to put on the glass, to protect the glass, instead of having paper cutting exercises, making little animals, you know, and tigers and bears and things, they cut up strips and gummed them on the window, and they thought that was enormous fun because they covered themselves with gum, you know, got very sticky. And then, of course, they usually have a gardening period each week. They have a garden, they dig vegetables, plant vegetables. And so instead of the gardening, they had, you know, trench digging. And so the very biggest ones dug, and the little, very small ones carried away the earth, piled it up into a wall. And then, of course, when they were getting into the trenches, we played it as hide and seek. You know, the teachers usually take them for games. So this was just another game. They jumped into the trench, hid their heads, put their hands over their ears, had to keep quiet until the teacher blew the whistle again. And so it was like waiting for the all clear, you know. But of course some of them really enjoyed it so much, rather too much, and the sound of the siren, three of the little ones were so intrigued by this that the next day they imitated the sound of the siren outside, and of course the whole school fled into the trenches, and it was a long time before I discovered who the culprits had been. However, it was better it should be that than have fear for it.
Now the older children presumably knew exactly what the situation was. How did they react?
Well, some of the older children were definitely, I think, afraid. Partly they were afraid of the unknown. The sound of the siren, I think, is enough to paralyze quite a number of people. Then, of course, they have heard of atrocities in Tibet. Many of them have Tibetan relations who came out in 59 or perhaps even later. And the stories, whether they're true or not, have definitely had an effect.
What sort of stories?
Well, of atrocities committed perhaps against the lamas in Tibet. So many of the children here are Buddhists, and they go to the monastery here, they know all about the lamas. If there's sickness in the house, lamas come. If there's death, the lamas come. Therefore, when they hear about these things happening to lamas in Tibet, so many of them being killed, forced to work on the roads, and other sort of horror stories, which, as I say, may not be true, it definitely did affect them. But even so, although they were from time to time possibly afraid, particularly when the siren actually blew, even so they went on with their first aid. They came to school as usual. They learned bandaging fractures, how to take care of the immediately wounded, and then of course they also dug their own trenches. And of course here we only have one male teacher, our Tibetan teacher. And so the children decided he must have his own little trench. And so they dug a special trench for him, quite separate from all the rest.
How do you feel about being the only European in Sikkim?
Well, really, I've been here about 6 years now. And I honestly don't notice that I'm the only European. Because there are so many people who speak English. And there are so many people who are very, very friendly. I find sometimes visitors come up, but even if they don't come up, I find I'm perfectly happy here. I love the work, I love the place, and the people are so delightful that it just doesn't worry me in the slightest bit.
Miss Hamilton may not be worried. The people of Gangtok, still living largely in their feudal past, may not seem worried. But small states are often pawns in the game of power politics. And Sikkim, which lists orchids as a major product, is one of the smallest and weakest states in Asia. Gangtok has 25,000 inhabitants, and only 270 of them have telephones. Communication is a major problem in this remote state. It has no newspapers, no radio, and in some areas no roads at all. So rumors spread fast in the bazaar. And though children may still play happily in the streets of Gangtok, some of their elders are not so contented. They sometimes smile at the camera, but that's just because they like having their pictures taken. Buddhism is the state religion of Sikkim. It has 67 monasteries within its borders, but many Sikkimese may now wonder if their peace-loving religion can protect them against the threat from the north. They feel, anxiously instead, that their ultimate liberty rests in the hands of the troops who face each other across the snowbound border.
कंचन जंगासी यही हो हाम्रो धनको देश तपोवन हो प्यारो सिक्किम जहाँ बच्छ स्टारंगी जहाँ कंचन जंगासी यही हो हाम्रो धनको तपोवन हो प्यारो सिक्किम फुल्छन् यहाँ आँगनैमा चापागुराज सुन गरी स्वर्ग सही सुंदर देश का हमरा प्यारा प्यारा जन्मभूमि स्वर्ग सही सुंदर देश का हमरा प्यारा प्यारा जन्मभूमि जहाँ बच्चा विस्तार कंचन जंगासी यही हो हमरो धनको देश तपोवन हो प्यारो सिक्किम सदै Yehi Mato Kapu Lahu Hami Shraddha Bhakti Garu Samsadai Yehi Mato Kapu Lahu Hami Jaha Bhakta Pistar Ghi Jaha Kanchan Janga Si Yehi ho amro dhara kubesa Tapavan ho pyaro sikhim Buddham saranam gachami Dharmam saranam gachami Sangam saranam